Hey everyone, welcome to the 341st episode of the Internet of Things podcast. This is your host, Stacey Higginbotham, and your co-host,
Kevin Toefel.
And we have a, is it awesome? I think it's fun.
It's a cornucopia of things.
Yes, a cornucopia of things for you this week. We're going to be talking about, a warning for your holiday shopping. Amazon's plans for a smart fridge, a bunch of updates on Google projects, plus Google's sustainability event, which had kind of an interesting twist. We've got some new products from companies that you're going to be interested in, including Starling, Rack Wireless, and a Kickstarter that, is this adorable or is it just a tinier nightmare? We'll debate that in a moment. We also are going to touch base on some cybersecurity news, and in last week's newsletter, I wrote about the FDA's efforts to add traceability to the food supply, and I've got an update on that story with a contract for Siemens and digital twins for food factories. We also are going to hear from our sponsor, Trek 10, and our guest this week is Sanjit Pandit, who is the head of smart cities at Qualcomm. He's going to be talking about their event that happened last week and what the heck COVID-19 did for or against smart cities. So all of this awaits you. But first, a message from one of our sponsors. This week's sponsor is Ayla. Ayla Networks is a leading provider of edge connectivity, device management, and application enablement for the IoT. Ayla enables the world's largest companies to connect any device on any cloud to any application. With the fastest time to market, it's also flexible and future-proof with increased operational efficiencies and allows you to enhance your customer's overall experience. So if you would like more information on connecting your product with Ayla, please visit www.aylanetworks.com. All right, Kevin, I am sure you're aware of this, but if you've been hiding under a rock this year, you'll be aware that the pandemic has disrupted supply chains, including semiconductors. Shipping is taking longer. I can't buy sheets for my bed.
Helium hotspots.
It's just crazy. With that in mind, big retailers like Target and Amazon are extending their holiday season to now. Basically, October is going to be when Black Friday is. It's going to be like deals all October long because everybody wants you to buy early. One, because it's going to help their bottom line, but two, because they want you not to be upset when your stuff ships and is late. And I get that, actually. I've been buying my Christmas presents for people early.
Oh, goody.
Yeah. Kevin, you're not on the list. What?
What?
No. So if you are in that mindset, we're going to try to get our holiday gift guide out a little bit earlier this year. We usually do it for Black Friday itself, but we're probably going to be doing it at the end of October. So stay tuned for that.
Has there been anything that you were trying to order that is like totally delayed out of curiosity? Because a couple of my neighbors have mentioned appliances. They're on a 26-week wait list for a new refrigerator, for example.
I just bought a hot tub.
Mm-hmm.
And initially I was told it would be 12 to 18 months, but I did find a hot tub that will arrive in February. I also bought I needed sheets because my parents are coming to stay with me, and I had to go to 5 different places to order sheets. And this was actually, I ordered them initially at the beginning of September, and they were delayed, so then I had to go order some other ones. So yes, not all of these are devices, but...
Right, I was just going to say, but it's interesting to me that it's expanded beyond chips and devices, because last November, 11 months ago, is when I got my NVIDIA graphics card, the brand new ones they came out with in November. And I was just on a website, and you still can't get them. People are scalping them for 3 times the price, like $3,000 for these graphics cards. I'm not surprised, but it's amazing to me how it's now gone to so many other consumables and products, you know.
Well, you know, I was working on a story, and I was looking at some financial information, and this was for Arlo. And they actually report that they're freight costs for bringing in devices and components to manufacture, they're
sky high.
Up 89% year over year. And this was at the end of June.
Yeah, I mean, for people outside of the U.S., I mean, I'm sure everybody's going through this, obviously, but what I've seen is a lot of news reports and photos of cargo containers either sitting on cargo vessels, like dozens of vessels outside of major ports in the U.S., or hundreds and hundreds of containers offloaded, but there's nobody to...
No truckers. Yeah, so there are like 62. At the beginning of this week, there were 62 container ships off the port of Long Beach in LA just waiting. So that's like 3 weeks' worth of stuff. A lot of companies have switched from cargo to air. Coca-Cola's moving their stuff in on like coal ships instead of container ships. And here's the other niggle. So once stuff gets in, when you're talking about shipping stuff to the consumer that's already made, there are delays, like FedEx is having a staffing shortage. I have had my Twinklies Christmas lights. Y'all know I love my fancy, expensive Christmas lights that are internet controlled. Yay! I ordered 2 boxes of them, and they are stuck in Troutdale, Oregon, which is FedEx's Oregon area distribution center. They've been there for a week.
Yep.
And that particular distribution center is only staffed right now at 65% capacity. So there's delays. It's not just ships, not just container ships. It's everything.
And I would even go one step further back, because this is definitely, I think, going to be worse before it gets better. Aside from all the supplies that we have just sitting around that we can't move, and not to single this country out for any other reason other than they are like the major production powerhouse, China production is starting to slow down because of energy challenges, and literally the government is not allowing them to burn as much coal and so on and so forth. So even at the very production line bit, it's going to get worse, I think, for I don't know how long.
So I would say, and this is just crazy, right? Maybe this is, we're finally pricing in some of the externalities that we've ignored for decades.
Yeah.
So think of this as like technical debt for the environment, for labor, for all kinds of things. And it's coming due now, and maybe we need to rethink what we really need or want. I know, that's crazy. Okay. I'm like, let us tell you about our gadgets later.
Speaking of what you need and want, do you want a fridge from Amazon? I suspect the answer is a big fat no.
Okay, Business Insider is reporting that Amazon might be working on its own smart fridge. It's called Project Pulse internally, and it's basically pulling some technology from the Amazon Go stores, like shelf weights, cameras.
Ugh.
And it's basically designed to like see what you buy and see when you run out of stuff. And I think of last month when Amazon announced their Halo Nutrition service that's, well, it's actually part of the Halo service, but it's called Nutrition, and they were trying to help you meal plan, basically, for, you know, whatever goal you might set for healthy living, for weight loss, whatever. So they'll help you meal plan. Well, something like this integrated into that is obviously awesome if you're like, hey, Madam A, check what's in my fridge and then order it for me. Or check what's in my fridge and tell me what to make this week. And anything I don't have, order it.
Where would it order it from?
Yeah, so that's where it gets like, since it's going to order it from Amazon, Amazon's a price arbitrage company. So sometimes when I go look at a price for something and then I come back 2 days later, that price has changed based on what Amazon thinks I'm after.
The other thing is, and a lot of people don't realize this, the prices are different for different people at the same time.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
So knowing all this, I'm like, yeah, Amazon, you can't be in charge of this. I don't want your fridge. I don't want your nutrition service. But I want it. Here's what I wanted. I wanted open standards and data models for food so we could build this independently and everything could work together using APIs.
I don't disagree with you, but I don't think that's going to happen. If they do go down this path, they probably have the best chance of success here. And frankly, I think I've said this before, but if I haven't, I don't see Amazon as a technology company. I see them as a logistics company.
I see them as a services provider, but okay, yeah.
Okay. But their goal is to get things to people as quickly as possible. And that even means predicting what they need or using technology to see what they need before they realize that they need it. So yes, there's only an eighth of a cup of milk in there. I can tell by the weight. I'm going to let them know, or I'm going to order it for them or just deliver it. So I don't know that I want Amazon to be in charge of all that personally, but
I don't want any one company. It's a terrible idea. It's conflict of interest all the way through. So no, this is why we need open standards for the smart home. It's also why we won't get it, because companies recognize the ways they can make money on this quote unquote ambient intelligence. Yeah. All right. Speaking of giant companies making money on the smart home, let's talk about Google. We've got a bunch of little Google newses. Google newses.
Little Google's newses.
Yes. Don't snooze through the Google's news. All right. There's some device news. These were launched earlier, but they're now out. It is the outdoor camera with the motion sensing lights.
The floodlights.
Floodlights. Thank you. Yes. Thank you. What is that? The Nest floodlight camp?
It is.
Okay. And then they're also now on sale is the $99 indoor cam. That's the cheapest Nest cam you can buy, although it's not the cheapest internet connected camera you can buy. It's part of their whole like light pastel color design aesthetic. It's got a wooden base that you can, if you want, use that has that natural friendly home feel. And, you know, it works with all the Nest stuff. I will say, having now spent 6 weeks with the Nest doorbell and the Nest indoor outdoor cam, I hate the software. I hate it so much. In my review, I mostly talked about hardware because that's where I spent the time. But the fact that it's all integrated through Google Home, when you have a lot of devices like I do on Google Home, it is a mess. I go in there and it takes like an extra second to get to whatever I wanted to see. I hate it.
Yeah. Yeah. There is one aspect of this that I like. I'm just going to mention the colors because only one has the wood base. That's the sand with maple wood base. Then there's snow, which is white, fog, and linen. One aspect that I really like, though, it has a 2.4 and 5 gigahertz Wi-Fi radio.
Oh, they finally upgraded their radios. Nice.
Yay.
That means if you've got a mesh network, it should be easier to connect it.
And Google's hoping that you do have a mesh network, probably the Nest Wi-Fi.
Yeah. Now, I mentioned the Google Nest doorbell, the most recent one, which I've been testing. That one is actually battery-powered or wired, so you can go back and forth. It's big, though. And then in tiny little product news from Google, the Google Nest Hub could get another gesture that you can use their Soli radar chip with. This one, you're going to be, right now you can hold up your hand to play and pause music, and then you can wave your hand to dismiss timers and snooze alarms. Now, 9to5 Google says that they're going to add a browse photos gesture, and that'll be it. Let you swipe through photos by waving your hand left or right in front of the Nest Hub. So that's coming. It's not out. I've used the gestures before, but I tend to just yell at Google when it's, you know, the timer. I'm always like, stop, stop.
Yeah, I don't know. It could just be me in my home. I don't know how many people go through slideshows on these things. Like I have it.
Oh, I do.
Oh, I don't go through slideshows. I have it set to my wallpaper, my screensaver, whatever you want to call it. So I get a new picture of Norm like every 15 seconds or whatever. It does that automatically. Would I sit there and swipe through all the pictures of Norm? No.
So ours is set for 1 minute. I think that's the default for bandwidth purposes. But I have it going through my family photo album. And sometimes something will come up and I'm like, oh, get rid of that real fast. Or my daughter, who's, you know, 15 and embarrassed by everything, sometimes does that too. So I'm like, yeah, maybe.
I mean, you could remove those from the album.
Yeah, she did tell me, like, when her friends come over, I'm only allowed to play certain albums. And they're really, quite frankly, very lame albums.
We just have one album. It's called Norm.
Yeah, I have more pictures than that. Okay, hey, let's talk about sustainability.
Oh, let's.
Google, kind of out of nowhere, decided they were going to do a sustainability event, and that's what they did. They announced a couple things. Only one of them really relates to the smart home. You know, Google's been talking up this stuff for a while, but they announced something called Nest Renew. And Kevin, you want to talk about that?
Yeah, it's interesting to me because it reminds me of what I used to do with my solar panels back about 8 years ago. Basically, if I'm understanding this correctly, and there's a whole long deep dive that Google has provided to the press, they're introducing Nest Renew. And what that will do is you can opt into this. And what Google will do is it will change your heating and cooling and potentially other devices in the future as they expand this, to use or to be powered on when it's either off-peak times or when there's more renewable energy being provided to the grid. So they do this for free, but then they also have this premium plan, which is where I'm really scratching my head, because this is a $10 a month subscription fee, And what it will get you, in addition to the bits I just talked about, it will get you detailed reports on your carbon offset by using renewable energy through the program. And Google will be buying and probably selling what are called renewable energy credits. So they make it sound almost like you'll be using your appliances when we're on renewable energy, but they're not controlling your energy supplier here. And I say that because I have worked with a company that does change my energy supplier based on renewable energy or not, based on my preferences. And I did pay for that service. You're not really using renewable energy through Nest Renew Premium that I can tell. You are essentially financing it and increasing demand for it by paying so that Google can buy and sell these renewable energy credits on the secondary market.
Which seems kind of lame, although it does. I mean, so Google and Facebook both have been working hard to create demand for renewable energy by like pledging to buy X amount to power their data centers. And this looks like a similar effort, but they're aggregating all the demand from homes, residential homes, basically, and saying, hey, I am going to provide or I'm going to pay for X kilowatt hours or X megawatts of renewable energy. And that incentivizes people to say, oh, there's demand here. Okay, I'm going to build it, right?
Yeah. And I should mention Energy Shift is the feature that will let you prioritize heating and cooling usage for lower grid emissions or lower costs. It's one or the other. The bit that gets me is there are already companies that do what they're trying to do, which is basically take the logistics out of the whole buying and selling of renewable energy credits. And I say that because I used to earn renewable energy credits when I created, you know, like a X number of kilowatt hours of renewable energy with my solar panels. So my distributor would buy the supply from me and I would get a credit as well. And I could sell those credits, which would change in value based on demand and so on. It was just so hard to sell them as a consumer that I gave up. I probably left a lot of money on the table. Google's doing that all for you in a sense, and they're doing it collectively for all the Nest customers. So there are, again, other companies that do this, and I have used them and I have paid a similar fee, but Google's aggregating all that. And so, I mean, if you're into that, I guess it's worth it, but
You're leery of doing it through Google? Just like I'm leery of putting an Amazon fridge in my house?
It's not that I'm not doing it because it's through Google. Like, I'm a unique case or somewhat unique because in Pennsylvania, we have energy choice, electricity supplier choice. We deregulated, I don't know, 10 years ago. My provider is the local utility company, and I always pay them for the distribution to get me my electricity. But the cost of the electricity itself, I can choose that supplier. And I've changed as many times, 3-4 times in a year based on I wanted to pay more to get more renewable energy, or at least pay for somebody to get renewable energy, or I wanted a lower cost per kilowatt hour. So I don't need Google to do this for me. Maybe there are listeners out there that are hearing this and going, yes, I want this. And I would love to have them call in and tell us why. Because maybe okay. I'm missing something. But again, I'm a special case here in Pennsylvania.
You're a special case, even if you weren't in Pennsylvania. Yeah. All right. Let's talk about some new gear out. One, this is actually not new gear. This is feature. This is a new feature on existing gear. So the Starling Home Hub, this is a smart home hub. A lot of people love it. It's kind of part of the, I would call it more DIY-ish. And it has now brought support for the latest Nest cameras to HomeKit. And video is always a pain because it doesn't translate from one ecosystem to another. And it won't even with Matter. So don't get excited about Matter because of video. So
this Starling Home Hub is unique in that it's not a home hub like a typical home hub. It is a very specific home hub to connect Nest products to Apple HomeKit homes. So you can get away from the Google app and all that, which you just said was kind of poopy. Maybe you should go HomeKit.
No, I don't have iPhones. Stop. Okay.
Starling and HomeKit.
There you go. So if this sounds like something you want to do, check out the Starling Home Hub. Okay. Rack Wireless. This is a company that made the original Helium minor LoRa Wi-Fi router device. They are now making a brand new brand. This one's designed for consumers. They're going to design Helium routers under this brand called Minted, and that is MNTD. These devices are actually sold out the first day they sold out. They're $400 helium hotspot miners. The difference...
which is in line with the price in general, I think.
So the pricing's in line. The difference here is that they're basically not going to sell you one of these unless they can supply it within 2 weeks. So they're doing, I think of it as like the Telfair purse launch, which like all 95% of the male audience probably just, I lost you there. But what they do is they make X number of purses and then they put them up and they're like, we're going to have a purse sale. And they go and you buy it when you can. And then if you miss that window, it's done. So then you got to wait for the next window. So that's what this is going to be like. Rack Wireless makes IoT gateways. They also made the helium routers under the Calchip brand. So some of y'all may have those. This is all part of like the helium network has just gone crazy in terms of both the price for the network tokens that people can get for mining, but also just by growth of these things. When I first launched my, turned on my hotspot back in April of 2020, there were probably about 20-something thousand hotspots. Today, there are 217,570 hotspots. And I guarantee by the time you hear this, there's going to be like 10,000, maybe 20,000 more. So there are a lot of hotspots running around.
I wish other companies would take this approach. And then it's not just because I'm being salty about Nebra taking my money in March and still not shipping me my hotspot. It's just a bad customer experience, you know? So I like this approach.
I think everybody's been caught off guard. So there's the component shortage. What I didn't realize, and I probably should have realized this, all of the routers, all of the helium miners use Raspberry Pis as their computer board, as part of the spec. If they change that, that opens up the number of suppliers where they can get stuff, but Pis are kind of hard to come by sometimes.
Yeah, you know, I'm starting to wonder if I should take one of the Pis that I have here and just get a LoRaWAN radio that's compatible, wouldn't be too expensive, and just do it.
Yeah, because they also talked about like copper prices. Remember for a while, those went shot sky high and they were like, oh crap, we can't make antennas without copper. So there's a lot of, they've been working really, really hard. They've doubled their manufacturing capacity. I just don't know.
And actually the Pi people, we just talked about the funding they got maybe 2 weeks ago, and that's part of their plan as well, is to expand production. So
other cool devices, I don't know, maybe this will be under your Christmas tree, but it won't arrive by then. Let's talk about a Kickstarter that Kevin, I can see loving.
I didn't back this yet. I'm thinking about it. And actually, I believe it runs on a Raspberry Pi as well. I'm not going to say what it is yet. I'm going to tell everybody or ask everybody, are you familiar with the super scary Boston Dynamics robot dog, that yellow dog that climbs open doors, does backflips?
It's terrifying.
And just freaks us out? Yeah. This is that on a really small scale. It's called the Mini Pupper. It is open source, which I love. It is a robot dog kit, and it literally mimics the Boston Dynamics robot in look and functionality, just at a, you know, again, a smaller scale. So it looks very interesting to me, A, because I like robots, B, because it's open source, which is very cool. You can do whatever you want with it, but they give you some projects and so on, but it has the same legs and can dance around and trot and everything else. It's self-stabilizing. I guess you could push it, although being so small, I mean, it's literally... it's a Raspberry Pi with a touchscreen for the face, and it also has gyroscopes.
It runs ROS, the open source robotic operating system. Astro does not run on that.
It's a 3D printed dog case. I don't know if you realize that. It's 3D printed. So if you want, if you have a 3D printer, you can buy or you can back this with just the guts of it or the software, and they'll give you the file so you can 3D print your own little dog case. It's about $279. All the pledges are in Hong Kong dollars, I believe, $2,169. But just basically to get 30% off the basic kit is get you $279. They say they're going to ship in November. We will see. You can go up from there and you can get the charger, the battery, the whole shebang, you know, and it'll cost you about $384. Do we need this? No. Do I want this? Yeah, I do.
All right, let's switch to... cybersecurity news, which we really haven't had a lot of bad cybersecurity news for a while that we've focused on. So yeah, let's change that because there's a new report out from Nozomi Networks and the SANS Institute. And basically, the positive news is companies are investing more in industrial control systems cybersecurity Yay!
Good.
47% of people of the 480 responses, 47% of those people said that their ICS security budgets have increased over the last 2 years. 32% said there had been no change. Now, half of the respondents said they didn't know if their organizations had suffered from a cybersecurity incident in the last 12 months. Yeah, I'm like, ooh, you should probably know that. Good monitoring is going to be part, like, that's an essential element to good cybersecurity.
Yeah. We've got a great system. It doesn't tell us anything, but we know it works.
Now, those who did say they had cybersecurity incidents, and that was just 15% of them, they did say they were able to detect the compromise within 24 hours. 30% were able to detect compromise in under 6 hours. So, sounds like if you're looking for it, you've probably found it, and your detection systems are pretty quick on the uptake. People are really worried about this, and they say the survey says 70% of respondents had some form of monitoring program in place for OT security, and 76% said they have conducted a security audit of their OT and control systems in the past year. I don't know why they're not finding more breaches, though.
Well, don't forget, they may be finding them and not disclosing them.
That is fair. Anyway, yeah. So this is, we'll put a link to this because this is good data for people who are, I'm very worried about cybersecurity on industrial controls. Cybersecurity on industrial control systems. These are the control systems that control things like manufacturing processes, oil
pipelines.
And gas, pipelines, water plants, electricity, just all that stuff. You can find more of this in our show notes. We'll link to that. And on that note, which I don't know if that was a positive note or not, we are going to end this.
It was a note.
It was a note. We're going to end this segment of the show and focus on the Internet of Things podcast hotline, which is where we hear from you. Ta-da! Where you ask your questions of us. The IoT Podcast Hotline is brought to you by Very. Very is a fully distributed IoT engineering firm that partners with clients to build systems for smart manufacturing, smart energy and utilities, consumer electronics, and connected wireless. Discover what Very's multidisciplinary teams can do for you at verypossible.com/services. And if you would like to call us and leave us a voicemail, we're at 512-623-7424. And if you call us in October, which is now the month we're in, you will be entered to win. You know what? I'm going to keep it a surprise for another week because I've got two options and I don't know which one I'm going to go with. So you should still call us though, because it's going to be a good surprise. Don't worry. And because it's the end of the month, it also means we have a winner from September. So big congratulations to Brian from Denver, and I will be reaching out to you so you could pick which smart speaker you would like to win. Actually, you're already entered to win. You've won, Brian.
Yes, he's called, he's entered,
and he's won. Yay!
Congratulations on all three.
But, you know, anyone can call and enter, so you should do that at 512-623-7424. And now, let's hear this week's question, which I can't believe no one's asked this before. So, Derek, thank you for this. Let's hear it.
Hi, my name's Derek. My question for Kevin and Stacy is, I currently have Ring devices surrounding my house, but I'm on all Google Home devices, and I'd like the Nest integration, but it seems wasteful to buy all new Nest cameras and doorbells to offset my Ring and then throw away or give away the old Ring gear. Is there any recommended place to sell old IoT hardware? Thanks for the answer. Bye.
Oh, Derek, as a person who has many devices that I'm either selling or giving away through fun IoT podcast giveaways, I love this question. And I usually sell my stuff on eBay. I know that's not very exciting, but that's just been the best place for me to sell it. I get decent prices. Someone always wants even like really old stuff. If it's old, I just make sure I'm responsible about disclosing things like, hey, this is probably only good for parts because it's been deprecated, or hey, this requires a subscription to work really well. So just if you do that, list responsibly.
Yeah, and also speaking of being responsible, make sure that you factory reset these devices.
Oh, yeah.
You don't
yeah.
want your data on there.
Factory reset them, deauthorize your device. Sometimes you can do it through the app. Sometimes you have to do it through the hardware itself. So before you unplug it, figure that out and do it.
Yeah, and another option, because I go through the same thing, and I tend to ask my neighbors and friends first if they want one of the devices, and I just donate it to them. But if I want to sell them, you know, I would also go the eBay route. But I've also bought and sold a lot of tech over the years from swappa.com, S-W-A-P-P-A.com, mainly for two reasons. One, they have very reasonable sales fees. It's all set pricing. And two, it's a really good community. I've bought and sold from some of the same people through Swappa because I trust them. And it's that kind of service where it's almost like a family. And more importantly, even though I've only sold computers and things in the past that are not IoT, they have now opened up to selling and buying home technology. So I see on their page, they have Google Assistant products, Madam A products, Sonos, Nest. I see people selling Ring doorbells if you want to, you know.
Or Ring cameras. Do you see any Ring cameras?
Yeah, yeah. There's a Ring floodlight cam for sale on there. There's Ring Video Doorbell 2s, Ring Video Doorbell 2 Pros, Ring spotlight cam.
Do you see a Ring indoor camera, like just a Ring indoor plug-in camera? Because I've got $50 for this on eBay right now is what I'm seeing from a price perspective.
So
I'm curious.
We are trying to see if Stacy can make more money on Swappa. The Ring indoor camera, the Ring indoor security cam?
It just says indoor cam, so I don't know which version. I'm looking at this and I'm like, oh, I can't tell which version it is. It's 1080p.
They do show them as products that they would buy or sell here, but none are currently available.
All right. Well, let's see. How about what other options do you have in the Ring world?
I mentioned the floodlight cam, the spotlight cam wireless, the video doorbell 2 and 2 Pro, the floodlight cam wired Pro. That's all that's currently for sale there.
Oh, that's $179 or $169.
I guess that's good.
How much can you sell yours for?
$210.
$210. Okay. So looking good there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Shopping with Stacy.
Shopping with Kevin and Stacy. We're terrible at this. Okay. So the point is that was, you may want to check both places and see who gives you the best deal. But as Kevin pointed out, there's a community on Swappa and it's kind of nice to have a community. And eBay sometimes has weird, weird policies mm-hmm. and fraudsters.
And actually, I should say, I on Swappa one time, not too long ago, somebody bought a product from me. It was an Apple product, $500 I sold it for. I don't remember what it was, probably an iPad or something. And the payment was reversed, even though I had already sent the item out because I was told I got the payment. It was a fraud. And Swappa said, "You're covered. We got you." And they made sure I got my money.
Wow. Nice.
Yep. And it was no hassle whatsoever. That email address is banned from Swappa now, of course.
Okay. Well, there you go, Derek. So thanks for thinking about selling or donating your devices. And again, I will say Derek's problem is one that is not going to be solved by Matter. So if the video camera is important in your smart home setup, you're going to still have to pick an ecosystem. I just feel like I must remind people of this because
yes.
It's important. Matter will not solve everything. Okay.
You're like an IoT school teacher.
Exactly.
I must remind you.
I'm the Matter school marm. All right. That concludes the IoT podcast hotline segment. Remember, if you would like to call us and ask us your question, we can be reached at 512-623-7424, and you will be entered to win a mystery prize. Whoa. I don't know where the spooky laughter came from. It's October. And now get ready for Sanjit Pandit, who is the global head of smart cities and digital transformation at Qualcomm. He's going to be talking about what we're looking for in smart cities in a post-pandemic world and moving beyond smart lighting, thank goodness. But before we get to him, we're going to hear from our sponsor. This week's sponsor is Trek 10. Hey everyone, we are taking a quick break from the Internet of Things podcast for a message from our sponsor. This week's sponsor is Trek 10, and I have Carlos Limas here, who is the IoT practice head at Trek 10. To get started, why don't you tell me about what y'all do at Trek 10?
Sure. At Trek 10, we're an AWS premier partner, and we focus on building cloud infrastructures for clients across different verticals, ranging from supply chain to food industry to the energy sector. And what's more is we have a unit dedicated exclusively to IoT. And that's for those clients who are building smart products or connecting legacy systems or their manufacturing operations up to the cloud. So we got our clients through the process of connecting their products to AWS and doing so at scale and ensuring that data flows reliably to and from their IoT devices.
Excellent. So because you've seen IoT applied in so many different contexts, what are some of the gotchas companies may not be thinking about when they're launching a product?
Yeah, so I would say that the biggest blind spot we've seen across the board when undertaking IoT projects is having proper monitoring in place. You know, when you have only a few devices and a handful of them go out of service, you can normally just send an engineer out to resolve the issue. But once you start having as little as a few hundred devices, it's very important that you have a centralized way to understand the health of your entire fleet. Furthermore, it's essential to have a means to send data and commands down to your devices. Like if you want to request that an individual device or group of devices download a firmware update, for example, and proper monitoring will help you resolve any issues that might occur at scale from a centralized location. And it also serves as a means to prevent incidents through activities like rotating certificates for a group of devices or requesting that an individual device sends you diagnostic data about itself.
So how does Trek 10 help tackle these issues?
We have a solution called the IoT Resource Monitoring Framework that leverages services like AWS IoT, Device Defender, CloudWatch. And we also use Datadog, who's a close partner of ours. And we use this solution to help clients understand what is happening to their devices out in the field, such as, you know, how many are online, how much data they're sending, metrics like CPU, memory, and so on. And you know, what's more, we provide insight into the health of the backend workload, like database load, number of Lambda invocations, API requests, and so on. So whether a client chooses the IoT resource monitoring framework or they want a more custom solution with specific device metrics, we have the talent and the experience needed to provide visibility at scale and to do so in a timely manner.
That sounds great. So where can people go to learn more about Trek 10?
To learn more about how we can help you achieve your vision for IoT, please visit us at trek10.com/IoT podcast.
Hey everyone, welcome back to the Internet of Things podcast. This is your host, Stacey Higginbotham, and today's guest is Sanjeet Pandey, who is the global head of smart cities at Qualcomm. Sanjeet, thanks so much for coming on the show today.
It's my pleasure. Thank you very much for having us.
Excellent. So I just want to dive right in. Qualcomm has talked about smart cities, I feel decades is too long, but at least the last, I'm going to say 5 to 10 years. We've been having one conversation and then the pandemic struck, and I feel like we probably are having another conversation. So can you talk to us about what's happened in the smart city environment in a post-pandemic or a raging pandemic world?
Absolutely. Let's do pre-pandemic and post-pandemic discussion, if that makes sense. Pre-pandemic, the only thing smart cities really gravitated to was smart lighting. That was something that was tangible, visible. Cities could see it. Mayors could see it. Very basic smart lighting. That's about it. And there were some other citizen enablement plans and internet kiosks for tourist applications, et cetera, et cetera. Fast forward comes the pandemic. The pandemic has played a huge catalyst to adoption of smart city technologies globally. It has really opened the digital divide, made it very clear as to how connectivity was lacking, how distance blended learning education was needed, how remote healthcare required to be adopted. Now you must be saying, oh, well, wait a minute, that's not smart cities. The key is we live in cities. People live in cities. Technology gets adopted in cities. Use cases are deployed in cities. So our practice here at Qualcomm is surely smart cities and smart connected spaces. So healthcare is a space. Education is a space. So we are connecting the unconnected arena, not just deploying technology for the sake of it, but deploying technology to solve a particular use case to enrich the life of the people who live in the cities. So why it may not be a physical installation of a city, it touches the intangible aspect of socioeconomic areas where you are offering remote healthcare, you're offering remote learning, you're giving easier transportation, on-demand, dynamic transportation requests. So the pandemic did play a huge role in this. It also enhanced the need of broadband connectivity to a point that cities have now started putting their own private LTE networks under the CBRS band. And all this only happened because there was a trigger point or a pivot around which there were glaring needs exposed. So to answer your question, yes, we had two conversations, but both of them are, I would say, poles apart.
Okay, well, let's dig into that just a little bit because, you know, I used to cover broadband and it's my favorite thing in the world. So what I'm hearing you say is that the pandemic really changed the conversation and regarding need to access broadband. And I know we think of that most often as being wired, so thinking about fiber, DSL, or cable internet access. But you're talking about kind of creating wireless networks, which cities actually tried to do way back in the early aughts with like mobile Wi-Fi networks. So why are they choosing LTE, which feels like way more expensive? What is kind of happening there?
Actually, it's not way more expensive. It is much more to the fact that it is a private LTE network in areas where they're going to put in small cells and APs to offer wireless broadband to the underserved communities. As a citywide, city-offered private network, they don't have to pay for the license. It's citizen band. It's open spectrum, CBRS. The deployments are fast with outdoor APs, indoor APs going in. It's cheaper. And most important, they are going to market faster. They are reducing the dependency to a certain extent on the carriers, on the operators, who may not see financial return in these areas because they may not have revenue-generating customers. And that's where the cities step in. And this is a complete shift in paradigm.
So the idea is the carriers and the broadband providers aren't standing in the way of these because the people who would be buying it wouldn't have bought it anyway?
There are areas in cities which don't have coverage. There are areas in the cities where have coverage, but the people over there cannot buy them. The administration is giving them funds to say, okay, please give broadband connectivity to these underserved communities, either through an operator, or if there is no operator coverage, do something about it. And when that do something about it is where the cities are going in and say, okay, we may even put in our own private network to offer this through the grants that we get.
Got it. Okay, so that makes sense. So now we have coverage. Let's talk about applications. You've mentioned healthcare, you've mentioned education. These are now things that cities are talking about as part of their smart city initiatives?
Yes. So now what happens is once you have the roads built, which is the coverage, then you have various types of cars that you need to bring on those roads. And that's the analogy. They're like, okay, let me give them a connected laptop. Let me give them a remote patient monitoring kit at home, so that the vital data parameters are being transmitted back and the senior citizens don't have to drive all the way. My grandfather is 89 and I wouldn't want him to drive and stand in line and go to the doctor's office. I mean, if we can, those parameters, blood pressure monitoring, glucose, et cetera, can be monitored back to his nurse or health caregiver and seen by a doctor remotely, that's awesome. So those are the kind of new ideas that are coming to the cities. And the top three or four areas that I think applications are being now looked at are education, hybrid and remote learning education, offering, you know, fantastic healthcare services from remote patient monitoring devices and monitoring that data. Third is just basic broadband connectivity. And the fourth one, a reason of that, is having better accessibility to trash management, you know, having Wi-Fi on streets, public city Wi-Fi, so that you can have other stuff in and around that area, and that has a sensor in it. You won't send that truck out there every day to empty it, even if it's not full. It's a dynamic on-demand servicing to those trash cans. By the way, you save on gas, you save on time, you save on everything. So but you need that basic connectivity in that region. And having that really makes you open up a complete new box of applications and services right on top of that.
True. You cannot have the Internet of Things without the Internet. Okay. So the latter category is what we usually think about when we think about smart cities. We think about sensors on trash cans and traffic signals that respond to the actual traffic flowing through. Are we any closer to that? How have cities' conversations about those use cases changed?
Traffic lights have been there in some cities for 10 years, 20 years, some of them for 40 years. Some are on the poles, some hang through the wires, if you remember. There are times now that these are not synchronized, they're not smart enough. There are these traffic monitoring boxes on the streets. Now, cities are coming back and saying, it's time to upgrade this. We upgraded the roads, we made them a little bit wider, as much as they could. They would love to have more roads, but there's limitations. And they're coming to us and saying, okay, Qualcomm, how can we work with you in smart traffic management, ITMS, intelligent traffic management systems? How can we reuse our existing legacy technology? How do we put in sensors? How do we put in vision intelligence cameras that would be able to predict and prescribe traffic patterns, solve the problems that we have? And we are working with the cities right now to kind of see how we can do that. And there are very big cities. I cannot name them, unfortunately, because we always let the cities announce that first before we do, that will be announcing with us very advanced intelligent traffic management systems coupled with CV2X, cellular vehicle 2X, that would allow for safety, security, traffic pattern flows, and most important, prescriptive analytics. Example, if somebody's speeding in at 60 miles an hour on an intersection which is 30, and the camera and the intelligence thing picks that speed up, and if that's the case, he's going to run a red light. There will be some prescriptive actions taken in anticipation that this guy is not going to stop. That would prevent, hopefully, an accident. At least some kind of prescriptive preventive analytics will be in place. Those are the kind of things that the cities are really looking to. And this is what we have. This is what we can deploy. This is what we are deploying. But I'm not going to steal the thunder with city and where. You will surely hear and we will have another conversation.
Okay. Well, can you tell me when? Because I feel like we have been talking about a lot of this for a long time.
Now.
And now. It's happening now. Okay.
It's happened now. We have to announce. They have to announce it. So let's put it that way. I can tell you what was officially announced, and that is the press release with Peachtree Corners in Atlanta, where we have got a commercially deployed CV2X system, cellular to vehicle, in their city on multiple junctions, traffic intersections, and they are planning to expand that towards all their city vehicles as well. There are multiple other cities with equivalent or more smarts being deployed.
And are these being deployed across a city in an innovation zone? I feel like innovation zones have been kind of frustrating for people.
No, these are not innovation zones. We are beyond that. Those are great press release articles, thought leaderships, pictures, PR. We are way beyond that in smart cities.
Okay, well, let's talk about how they're paying for this, because a lot of times, and I think as a citizen who lives in a city, I look at my city governments doing these deals with, you know, Qualcomm, Hitachi, Intel, Cisco, all the companies in this space. And I'm like, is the city going to own this data? Who's going to maintain this? What ownership do they have? I get very worried about those things. So talk to me about the business models that have worked and what y'all are doing there.
First of all, there's huge grants coming from the federal. The administration is moving down all that, and you have heard about that. Second, they are reallocating some of the money that they have after the pandemic towards this. Earlier, they had the money. They had to make a choice. Do they put it in ICT, information, communication, and technology? Or do they fix the sidewalks? Do they fix the swings on the parts? Or do they paint all the poles again? Or do they do something else or put a solar somewhere else? But now, we are seeing more and more allocations towards technology after the pandemic. So that's one area they get the grants. There's the tax dollars that come in. Third, there are PPP partnerships. There is public and private partnerships. Fourth, there are companies that Qualcomm has partnered with and collaborated with, like JLC Infrastructure, where they bring in the money to the cities in lieu of monetization and other business models that, you know, which are confidential. We don't share those, but we have our own ways to kind of recoup that money over a period of time. It takes time, but this is not a sprint. This is a marathon in a smart city game.
What would you say the biggest challenge is for governments looking to invest in smart cities? Is it hard to get citizens on board? Is it hard to pay for it? Is it hard to, you know, broadband, lack of broadband being a challenge? I'm just trying to think about the biggest challenges they face.
I think the biggest challenge the government or the cities face right now is lot of existing infrastructure. You cannot just get rid of that. Things are working, whatever pace they are, they're working. We pay our bills, you're able to do everything. You know, you're not on a standstill in our cities that you and I live right now, right? So things are moving. So they have to consider that big engine, which is there, and that they have to take that into consideration. That's number one. Second, integration, right? You have to integrate a lot of other stuff into that. Third, interdepartmental connectivity. Everything works in silos in the cities. They have to work together. No, it's like making the elephant dance. It takes a while.
I like that analogy. Okay, well, let's talk about how you're trying to address some of that, because last year, last December, y'all announced a fairly innovative SaaS program for cities to buy various smart city services. And I'd love for you to talk about why y'all did that. Y'all recently expanded it at your Smart City event at the end of September. So clearly it's probably going well. So talk to me about why y'all did it and what y'all have learned in the last almost year of this.
Number one, IoT is a fragmented, fragmented place. Number two, to put all this together and offer it as a solution, smart solution in a box, we needed somebody. We had to take the fragmentation and the heavy lifting out of the equations. Cities don't have CTOs. They don't have a huge R&D team. They don't have a team that can do all the DevOps. They don't have a team that can go and source the best of breed. They don't make chipsets. We had to step in and take all that role on us, and rightly so. Somebody else would have done it too, but we were first. And Stacy, if you're first, you're first. It's somebody else's job to come back and say they're better when they're second, not my job. We were first in this. We took it on ourselves. We took the fragmentation out. We took the heavy lifting out of the equation. And we went with a very fresh and unique approach where we had everything as a service, ready to deploy, plug and play. And guess what? We have announced 30 verticals, right from agriculture to chicken farming. I'm not kidding you. We have a live deployment in Thailand, chicken farming, smart chicken farming, to drone management, to warehousing, to traffic, everything out of the box, ready to go and deploy.
That's impressive, but are cities worried about buying these sorts of things as services when traditionally they built them and funded them with like bonds and that sort of thing? So it became an investment that the city owned and was responsible for over time. In this case, the city's just going to pay for the service forever, but it's not going to be something that they can ever pay off, I guess.
Well, that's not really 100% true, because there are some innovative business models we have put in the way. We have put in the mix, which are confidential, but in this models, the city benefits from year two onwards.
Benefits financially, like in terms of savings or benefits? I mean, just having smarter cities would be a benefit.
No, it's not just smarter cities. Those are the intangible aspects of it. I think the key is even financial returns, advertising revenue, some rev share, you know, some leasing cost. We are coming up with innovative ideas to tell the city how they can benefit from this. I mean, think about it. If I go to a city and tell them, you got to give me monetization rights for 7 years or 10 years, the city is going to say, okay, what are you going to give in return? Why would they give me that if they don't see a benefit?
Okay. We've talked about healthcare, education. We didn't talk about smart lighting, which I'm forever grateful for, because that was the main use case prior to the pandemic, as you mentioned. Are there any other big use cases that we should look out for, either as technologists or people who live in cities?
Well, I think the biggest use case in this case is going to be a lot of public city Wi-Fi. There's going to be a lot of new use cases evolving in terms of transportation, a lot of new use cases coming up in terms of senior citizen healthcare, monitoring, keeping our parks safe, keeping our beaches safe, keeping cleanliness on the highest level, monitor flooding, early warnings, prescription, prevention, all these things.
Nice. I will look forward to this. All right, Sanjeet, thank you so much for coming on the show this week.
Really appreciate you having me on. I look forward to having another discussion with you after some of the big announcements happen.
And that concludes this week's episode of the Internet of Things podcast. Please join us next Thursday, and don't forget to subscribe. And if you can't get enough IoT news, I would love for you to sign up at www.stacyonIoT.com for our weekly IoT newsletter, where we explain all kinds of things that we don't even get to on the show. Once again, thank you for listening, and please subscribe.